Hampshire Men's Prison, believe it or not, gets lectures up there. One thing I love about the humanities is not your tax dollars. It's all private donations. And most importantly, all programs are free and open to the public. That's why you didn't have to pay an entry fee, right, to get in here. And they're free to the libraries or historical societies or whoever happens to use them. So I'm probably preaching to the choir, but check out their website. They have a lot of programs around the area, not just here in Gilford. So if you see a program that looks really interesting, you can check it out. Or if you want Patty to book it, I think we're probably booked this year, but certainly next
summer,
year.
I can start booking.
You can start booking again in July. So they really have a wide variety of programs. I'm very proud to have been a part of them for so long. My name's Glenn Knoblock. I come from Wolfboro, where I've lived for many years. I'm a historian, author, and jack of all trades. So I've written 23 books. You see a few of them up here, including my book, Brewing in New Hampshire. I'm not going to tell you how to brew beer. Some of you can probably do that better than I am. But what I like, I'm a beer lover, of course, but what I like is a history of brewing and how it got started in our state and how it's evolved over time. And what's kind of interesting about New Hampshire, you know, we're a small state, small geographic size and population. But we always have some interesting things here, don't we, right? First in the nation primary and stuff like that. And New Hampshire has some interesting brewing history that's slightly different than, say, Massachusetts or Vermont or whatever. And I do like to highlight our local brewers, too, as I do throughout the program. Are they paid? No, I don't. They don't pay me. I wish I got free beer. I should probably try to work that out. But more importantly, they're all breweries that I've been to, know some of the brewers, and I just think they have great product. What's kind of interesting is New Hampshire's brewing tourism, so to speak, is, you know, kind of lagged behind other states, particularly Vermont. We actually have more breweries than the state of Vermont does, but Vermont seems to have this stellar reputation, and I have no problem with Vermont's beers, but as I tell people, I don't need to drive 2 hours to go to Vermont to get good beer when I can do that in New Hampshire. So I always say buy New Hampshire, buy local, and then you can buy Vermont stuff while you're passing through there too. So that's my pitch for the New Hampshire brewing industry. But you know, how did we get started here, you know, way back in the 1630s when we were first you know, first got going, and I'm going to try and use your computer here. What's interesting is that, you know, beer has always, in the beginning, was a vital part of our first colonist diet. You know, the water in the home country was not always potable, not fit to drink. Think of a large city like London or Liverpool or something like that, where they didn't have treated water plants like we do today. Let's just put it that way. So the water was not always great to drink. So they were used to drinking fermented beverages and producing their own beers for a long time. Really, you know, we think of tea as England's national beverage, but ales were their national alcoholic beverage. And they started those way back in the 800-900s AD. And they were originally unhopped. And then they started, you know, kind of first bringing in hops from the European continent and then growing their own. It's hard, a little bit harder to do in the English climate, but they can do it. So by from 1400 onward, their beers were hopped. And of course, ales were their number one product. That's what they transported to New England and New Hampshire, their love of ales. As I put up here, no age restriction. This little guy can have a beer if he wants because, you know, once again, it was just part of the table fare of the day. What's also interesting is beer early on was a purview of the woman, right? The man's out hunting, you know, farming, clearing the fields. It's a woman that's in charge of the foodstuffs at home and preparing them. And that included home brewing. So when we think of that, you know, we often, especially back in maybe a couple decades ago, thought of brewing as a man's world. It's really, that's really not the history. And kind of the way we've gone now, there are just as many women involved in the brewing industry and craft breweries, as well as young women, women of all ages consuming beer. So we've kind of gone full circle in that respect. Now, there were very few professions that women could have back in colonial times that were legal anyway. But owning a tavern, and if you were a tavern keeper before the advent of modern breweries, you brewed your own beer for your customers. So Rachel Webster out in the Isle of Shoals in the late 1600s ran a very raucous tavern out there, as you might imagine, catering to the sailor and fisherman crowd. It was almost shut down by colonial authorities a couple of times, but soldiers, the sailors loved her beer. Betty Strongman down in Dublin, widow Sarah Eastman down in Hollis. This was a great way that especially widowed women, young and old, could make a living by serving, you know, their beers. And, you know, this was the only way that you could get beer at home. And really in the beginning, it was the home brewery transported, you know, those traditions transported from England. And of course, every town, what's the one of the first buildings we built? We built a meeting house and a tavern almost right next door. So the tavern keep, but still the home brewing was where most everything was happening. That first settlement down at Strawberry Bank in Portsmouth, even by the 1630s, the colonists there, part of the Laconia Company, were writing back to Captain John Mason in England and saying, we need supplies. And the second supply in the list was money. The first, that was the first one. Second was beer. And they said they didn't have enough beer. And then clothes were third. So that was a vital part of our diet. You know, I don't know how many of you have a water bottle with you or somewhere in your car or nearby. The idea in the beginning, they complained when they had to drink, you know, some of the cool, you know, cold water running from our local streams and stuff. That was not what they were used to. That's not what they liked to do. They liked to drink beer. That was part of their diet. The colonists in Jamestown, Virginia, that's one of the things they wrote back to the home country about 1607. We don't want to drink water. We need more beer supply. So it was very much a part of our founding tradition, young and old. And like I said, brewed at the home level. We talked about the how that process worked. But on the commercial side of things, which is kind of where we're going to focus here, it's all about the tavern keeping business. And, you know, it's all about location. You know, one, a good location close to the center of town. So for that reason, many towns, like the town of Bristol, not far from here, you know, a couple thousand people there today, you know, had 9 taverns. Why? Because they all had to be close proximity where you could either walk or at least ride a horse, including at night. So you wanted something close by. And these taverns varied in scope. Some of them were very fancy. They were for the upper crust, you know, and then especially in the town of, say, Portsmouth or Exeter, where, you know, some of our colonial affairs and mercantile affairs were conducted. In some of the smaller towns, these could be very simple affairs, almost like someone's kitchen, you know, with mud-daubed walls and dirt floors and stuff. So they varied widely, you know, whether it's the judge or the merchant or the farmer after a long day plowing and harvesting wants to go to the tavern for a beer. Each had their own place to go. These advertisements, one from Boscawen in 1804, the other one Portsmouth 1801, really talk about these worlds and what they required. So on the left here, it talks about they call it a tavern stand back then, and how, you know, it's large, convenient, well-finished house, a new and very commodious stable. We'll talk about that in a second. 2 barns and all sorts of things. Most importantly, right, a good privilege of water conveyed in the new aqueduct, because you need good water to brew beer and stuff like that. And of course, the location is, you know, within 100 rods and has a fair view of an elegant new meeting house. So right there, it is a fact in New Hampshire and many places in New England. When we conducted town hall meetings, you know, in March, they might be convened in the meeting house, but oftentimes they moved to the tavern nearby where you could just kind of sit there in a little bit more, you know, convivial atmosphere and imbibe a few drinks while you're talking about the important issues of the day. And the same thing was true even on the Sabbath, right? You know, where you heard these hours-long sermon. In between times, you went to the tavern and had your drink. So that's kind of fascinating. Now, Portsmouth Bell Tavern was a very upscale tavern. I'll read it to you. It's in that old-fashioned script. The subscriber, the tavern owner, Seth Walker, informs his friends and the public that he has taken that central and commodious house lately occupied by Mr. Greenleaf as the Bell Tavern and has opened a public house for the reception and accommodation of ladies and gentlemen, travelers and others. So women went to taverns as well. That was part of the fun. And again, that was that old English tradition where pub night, right? You know, the families would go out a couple nights a week, and you know, today they still do that, whether they're throwing darts or watching soccer. It was kind of the same thing in the old country there. Seth Walker flatters himself he shall be able to entertain his guests in an agreeable manner. His table will be supplied with the best season and market affords. And most importantly, his liquors of every kind are pure and genuine. We'll talk about what that means in a second. His stable shall be well attended. Why are they putting that in there? And furnished with the best hay and provender. And of course, that phrase on the bottom, you know, his ambition ever will be to please all those who may favor him with their command. So seems like a pretty friendly place, right? So we think of New Hampshire, right, as a live free or die state, right? Now this was... you know, before that motto was even coined, you know, really we had alcohol laws in place by the 1720s. One of those said that beer had to be brewed from pure and genuine ingredients, thus the phrasing in the ad. Now, why was that? Can anybody imagine going to a tavern where the owner maybe watered down his beer or tried to serve it? Anybody been to a bar today where maybe they just opened it, you know, tapped a new keg and it just doesn't taste right, might be a little watered down. And some towns actually had tavern inspectors whose job was to go around and taste the beer. I want that job if I can go back in time and make sure that everything was up to par, so to speak. So that was a law. And also the stable has to be well attended. You know, New Hampshire law provided that if you were going to go to a tavern or stuff like that, the owner had to be able to provide hay for your horse or whatever, so that while you're imbibing, your horse can also eat. And it was kind of, you know, it's kind of like if you went to the tavern today and had them gassing you up at the same time, wouldn't that be nice? But so it's kind of interesting. The other law that was on the books very early by the 1750s was that every New Hampshire tavern, they could serve a wide variety of stuff. They had to serve either beer or hard cider. So you could serve Madeira wine, rum, if your town allowed it. There were some towns that were dry towns that would not allow any alcohol, so they'd have these, you know, alcohol-free taverns. Not very many. Francistown was one of them. But some towns restricted what they called the demon drinks, right? Rum, whiskey, the hard stuff. But no matter what kind of tavern, you could serve Madeira wine or whatever, but you had to serve either beer or hard cider. In the larger towns of Exeter, Portsmouth, Manchester, places like that, beer probably was more popular. In the rural towns, it was all about hard cider, because let's face it, any tavern keep with a property and one or two apple trees could brew, make enough hard cider to supply his customers, and that's what rural customers really liked, hard cider. I can't remember, there's the name of a gentleman who kept a diary, is rather famously published, and talked a number of entries in there about how he'd walk home drunk after imbibing his favorite hard cider and stuff like that. So hard cider was a very popular drink as well. So we had laws in the books that required that, but there were no age restrictions. Now, those who operated taverns had to be licensed by first the colonial authorities and then the state. So that was a privilege, and it was a very, you know, widely sought out one. So, you know, who was brewing early on in Guilford? Every town in New Hampshire had people that were brewing before the days of commercial breweries, which got their start in the 1850s. So probably in the center there, probably the first tavern was the Lawrence Tavern, operated by Ebenezer Lawrence. and then operated by a whole succession of guys, and it later became the Willard Hotel. You know, and this is during the time when White Mountain region and Lakes region tourism was really ramping up. So some of these taverns started out as simple affairs, and then they became these taverns and hotel establishments. Another one is Asa Eager's Tavern near the courthouse. I like it because one of the early state histories said that the litigants often drank here. Now, the court officials would go elsewhere in Laconia, or what is today Laconia, to drink, Merritt of the Bridge, but the litigants would drink here. And again, this was first Eager's Tavern, later operated by a bunch of other fellows there. There's another tavern mentioned called Sargent's Tavern that got its start about 1858. And one of the interesting ones is a guy that didn't have a tavern per se, but Captain James Fell, out of his own house. Now, it's unclear whether he charged it. He did it as a public service, but he served food and drink to locals during certain events on Meeting House Hill. So kind of an interesting thing. All these individuals, all taverns, you know, were brewing their own beer. That's what they served to their customers. There were some towns, some of the larger towns, might contract out with someone who's doing brewing operations out of their own home. That happened in the town of Stratham and Portsmouth. One of the Portsmouth, our largest town at the time, had many different taverns, and some of these tavern keeps contracted with other people outside the town to brew their beer and then transport it in. But that was a relatively rare occurrence in places like Guilford and Wolfboro. You know, they didn't have the means or even the need to do that, so they were brewing their own stuff there. Anybody related to any of these folks? All right, darn. I thought we might get some, have some luck there. So what kind of beers, and please feel free to get a beer, you're not going to bother me or whatever. So what kind of beer was being consumed? As I mentioned, ales, at first unhopped, and ales would remain supreme in New Hampshire and New England into the 1950s. So stouts were popular. The German beers or continental beers, lager and pilsner, didn't come along until much later. Really, after the 1850s, and I would say even after the 1870s, with waves of German immigrants coming into New Hampshire, briefly, really spurred that. So if you think about our history of brewing and what today, anytime a new brewery opens up today, right, what are they doing? It's an IPA, India Pale Ale, and that harkens back to that tradition. It is also true that India Pale Ale is the easiest beer to brew. Lager beers are actually harder to brew if you're making a true lager beer. So here you see the Granite State Ale, you can see the Port Sprout, these are all Portsmouth beers. And most of the brewing was being done in Portsmouth. A little bit later on in Manchester, we note one brewery in Nashua. We'll talk about a couple of the others here. In Laconia, I only know of one brewery, and it was also a guy who made telescopes. He was kind of an inventor and kind of a dabbler in all things. And we'll talk about why other towns weren't brewing, how that works. So just gives you an idea of how that was working. So all beers really were brewed pretty local until the 1850s, 1860s. And I like to point out the different styles of beer, you know. So we talk about some of the cool things that are being done today. I happen to be a brown ale guy. I love brown ales. And you throw some maple in there or whatever. I love maple. You know, when pumpkin, you know, beers first came out during the craft brewing revolution, everybody's like, oh, this is a great invention. It wasn't an invention. So back in colonial days, our brewers, you know, flavored their beer with adjuncts or things that they had on hand, okay? So if they couldn't get the hops that they were used to getting, and some of the brewers, even in Portsmouth, even colonial times, would write back and say, hey, we can't get hops. The first hops imported into New Hampshire actually came from Portugal, believe it or not. But when they couldn't get the hops, they found used what they could find around them. So it might be squash, might be pumpkin. Pine needles were a very popular one. Somebody is making that today. I don't know if it's being sold commercial, but there are recipes out there for that. A little bitter for my taste, but hey, you do with what you will on your what you can, you know, find, right? So oftentimes, whether you're having a maple double brown or whether you're really hearkening back to those colonial times and you think of our ancestors that were using these different ingredients, not because they were trying to be gourmets, although there were probably people experimenting, and I can imagine some farmers saying, hey, well, you know what, let's try pumpkin, see what the heck, maybe they'll be good. But they were doing it primarily out of necessity. So a funny thing, spruce tip beer was one of George Washington's most favorite beers. I don't know if you guys know this, George Washington, our first president, was an avid beer drinker, had his own brewery on his estate. And wherever he went, you know, all those places, Washington slept here. Of course, he made his tour through New Hampshire. His personal secretary, Tobias Lear, was from New Hampshire. His job was to procure beer wherever Washington went and get him something suitable to drink. So no doubt he had no problems in New Hampshire, but that must have been an interesting job. So that's one thing that we know. In my book, I actually reproduce one of Washington's recipes, some of which are held now by the New York Public Library. I often get asked, what about old-fashioned recipes for beer? They're very hard to come by. They're almost non-existent. There may be a few floating around out there, but if anybody tells you they have an authentic colonial recipe, I would seriously doubt it. It's possible, but it's like anything else, right? In cooking, you think, you know, brewing beer is a form of cooking, right? A lot of times, these guys didn't write down their formulas. It's not like Coke where it's hidden in a secret vault, right? So, you know, it was a lot of experimentation. And, you know, one batch, you know, was different, you know, from the next, so to speak. So so when you're sitting in the fall or, you know, if this spring you're having something, you know, this seems, you know, a blueberry ale or whatever, you're really hearkening back to those colonial days. As a historian, I kind of like that. I like to feel the thinking that I'm drinking something that someone was drinking 200 or 300 years ago. Now, those interim steps from the home brewing and kind of the tavern movement into the full-scale brewery were these small shops and stores. Sometimes we might call them the general store, like down in Portsmouth, John Bodge at his house in Daniel Street was brewing excellent strong beer. Everybody knows what strong beer, right? That's another term for that was ship's beer. It's over 10% alcohol. So it's not sessionable like what we have over here. That's the stuff that, if you're a sailor, that's what you want. By the way, if you shipped out on a ship leaving Portsmouth Harbor or, you know, any port in New England, part of the rations that you were guaranteed as a crew member was ship's beer. And woe to the captain who tried to give his sailors anything less than ship's beer. They would not be happy and would probably riot. So you can see why John Bodge is selling that. Notice by the barrel, the gallon or less quantity. So think about when you go into a brew pub or a, you know, brew tavern today, you know, say Kettlehead, you can get a growler, right? 64 ounces. You can get a crowler. I love that name, crowler. 32 ounces. So kind of the same principle here. A lot of these general stores, they might sell nails, kegs of nails and stuff like that. Some of them would actually sell yeast for people that wanted to brew their own beer, but they also sold beer that they brewed on their own. So that interim step before we get to the classic brewery that we think of today. And of course, there were a lot of things that were happening in New Hampshire even before the breweries came along. In the 1820s, the temperance movement, that idea of banning alcohol for moralistic reasons, got its start. And many a town had a, you know, ladies' temperance society. Now, there were also temperance societies that men joined, but women seemed to be the focus early on. It's your fault, I'm sorry. But many men joined these, and there were many prominent individuals that jumped on board with the temperance movement, believing that, you know, alcohol was one of the ills of society. So as a way to combat that, brewers came out with other things. So this is a handbill that was posted on the streets of our state capitol. I kind of like it because it reads like a snake oil salesman's ad, right? Champagne or small beer. Now, that's a very lightly fermented beer. Might call it near beer. It's less than 3% alcohol, and you know, fermented for a couple weeks at most. You know, and as Charles Hodgson says in his ad, this valuable article has long been sought for and lately discovered. That's a lie. It being the richest and most nourishing drink ever offered, another lie. You might be much better off drinking a stout or something like that, even for nourishment. Although many have sought to find out the invention of this beer, they have never been able to discover its genuine origin. Now, I guess I would say that's true, because it's lost in the mist of time. But they cannot unless they get a certificate from Charles C. Hodgson. So he's claiming the inventorship of it. And I like this part. He says, I shall keep at all times through the summer season the same kind of beer at my shop, opposite the American House, by the way, which is right opposite our legislative buildings where all the legislation was being passed, or otherwise in a cart, which will pass frequently through the streets. So once again, how different was it back then? You could sell beer on a brewery wagon going up and down the streets of town. My grandfather's from Connecticut. He remembers that as a young boy too, that you could just, you know, vendors would drive up and down the street hawking their wares, whether it was beer or milk or whatever. And the subscribers below, those street doctors, Peter Renton, Thomas Brown, and Tilton Elkins, consider it the most inoffensive beer in common use. Now, finally, a truth there, right? It is pretty inoffensive. Contains no active or deleterious ingredient. And those who use it will find it a valuable substitute for cider, porter, mead, etc. at all seasons of the year. So this is for people that really probably are thinking of going temperance and they don't want to go all the way there just yet. They like their beer. Or we can imagine a spouse being persuaded by someone to maybe lay off the liquor for moral reasons. And so this starts this battle that, you know, lasts for, you know, almost 100 years until Prohibition comes along. So, and, you know, obviously by the end of the 1800s, the battle would rage even more fiercely, and eventually the temperance movement would win out, at least temporarily. Now, what's the first brewery in New Hampshire when we think of a modern brewery, a modern facility? Now, you would think that might be in Portsmouth, because that was our major brewing center, but it was actually in Manchester. R.V. Burt, Reverius Burt, a German immigrant, manufacturer of pale amber and cream ale. Anybody like cream ale? Anybody have it? You're thinking of Genesee, I'll bet.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, back in the day. That ages us, by the way, doesn't it? Yeah. So cream ales were very popular back then. They're not very popular now, although I think one of the Manchester breweries does brew it, but it's not very popular. But pale amber cream ales then put up in hogsheads, barrels, half barrels. Notice, for retail and family use. And then he states again at the bottom, for family use. Again, this is table beer for all, okay? This is for everybody. Located right downtown Manchester. German immigrant, lasted about 2 years, and he kind of disappears. New Hampshire was kind of a pass-through state for when it came to German immigrants. By the 1850s, there were many Germans immigrating to America, and German brewmasters who were great at their job were a dime a dozen. You could get them anywhere. And they were primarily going to the bigger places, like, right, St. Louis, Chicago, Cincinnati, Milwaukee. So as these towns were being established as brewing centers in America, so New Hampshire was kind of a pass-through destination, and most of the time they did not stay.
Now, when was that brewery?
1852, yeah. John Swindell in the 1870s was really Portsmouth's biggest brewer. And he was actually an Englishman, said to imbibe a little bit too much of his own product, so brewed a very popular beer, but yet was never, all that successful of a businessman. So notice he talks about his superior pale brown amber. You'll also see the term stock ale, which was really another term for an IPA, often used because that was the standard ale that you were going to get. Down at his place on near the railroad depot in Portsmouth there. So $6 a barrel and a lot of stock ale on hand at John Swindell. So he's an early pioneer. And Portsmouth, like I said, was our largest brewing center. Although wherever there was a mill in New Hampshire, so Manchester's Amiskeg Mills down in Dover, anywhere there's Nashua, anywhere there was large milling activity, there was some brewing going on. Nashua and Manchester were a little bit more difficult because it was easy to get that beer down to Nashua from Manchester, not a far distance. But, you know, Manchester had their own breweries, Portsmouth had their own and stuff like that. And so really it was Portsmouth number one, Manchester number two, as far as brewing centers in the state. And there was a third one in the western part of the state that was not even close. Swindell was bought out in 1859 by a guy named Frank Jones. Anybody ever heard of Frank Jones? It's kind of fascinating because if you were in the seacoast of New Hampshire, you know Frank Jones. If you're in the center part of the state, you kind of know Frank Jones. You go to the north, the west, or the south, nobody's ever heard of Frank Jones. Well, he was our version of the Rockefellers, the DuPonts. He was our tycoon back in the day. But he got his start, born in Barrington, moved to Portsmouth at a young age, all just trying to make a buck. And he was a very astute businessman, even at a young age, selling rags, you know, newspaper and other things that were turned into paper. Cast iron stoves, that's kind of the equivalent of a car dealership today because everybody needed a cast iron stove. But then he happened to cross John Swindell and he said, you know, this guy's got something. He's got good beer. Not a very good businessman, by the way. So it's said, and I don't really believe it, but it's a good story, so I'm going to repeat it. It's said that he romanced John Swindell's wife to get the recipe for his ale. I don't know if it's really true, but Frank Jones was considered somewhat of a womanizer, so it's possible. And he went into business with John Swindell. Within a year, bought him out, literally, lock, stock, and barrel. That's where that term comes from. So he built this beer empire in New Hampshire. Very few people realize that he was the king of the ale makers. Now, he built himself as the largest ale maker in the world. Bass Ale in England was the largest ale maker in the world, but he was the largest on the East Coast, distributed all the way down to Baltimore, and had a wide distributorship all through New England. So he was a real deal. And you can see his brewery complex here on Islington Street in Portsmouth, very at the height on the left there. You can see the, you know, all the smokestacks going, and they were brewing a lot of beer that was being distributed. When you see the ads for Frank Jones, if it says Frank Jones Portsmouth Ale, you know it's a non-New Hampshire advertisement because you didn't need to say that in New Hampshire. In New Hampshire, everyone knew Frank Jones. He served in politics. He was also the chairman of the board of the Boston and Maine Railroad. Now, why was that important?
Distribution, transportation.
That's right. And this is the day right before monopolies were prevented. So he controlled the freight rates for everybody in Boston and Maine's service area, right? So other brewers, he could jack up their transportation rates as much as he wanted to. You know, that they were his competition. So that's kind of cool. He also owned the Wentworth by the Sea Hotel. So if anybody's ever seen that grand hotel down there in Newcastle today, it's still there. It's now it's a, I think it's a private housing, but it's a pretty impressive grand hotel of the
it
era.
It was a Marriott until recently.
Oh yeah.
Just sold it out.
Yeah. But there's a very nice marina there and stuff. Pretty impressive place. On the right, that is his personal estate. Now today, that's Woodbury Avenue Extension in Portsmouth. It's a private, a public road. But back then, that was his estate. Part of that Victorian era house is still there, but the fountains and the gardens. He was an avid racehorse collector. And like I said, he's a bit of a womanizer and stuff like that. So he was very, very well known in Portsmouth and, you know, really New England. But no matter what he did, he was involved too in the early telephone industry. He actually was had a case in the Supreme Court. If he had won, he might have been controlling, you know, what we today would call Ma Bell. Again, I'm dating myself here, but you guys know what I'm talking about, the original telephone monopoly. But he lost a Supreme Court case, and so he never became the telecom giant perhaps he wanted to be. But beer fueled his whole you know, lifestyle and everything. And he loved his brewery, by the way. I mean, he took a very personal interest in it. He once fired a teamster for whipping a beer draft horse too heavily. And so he really had played a hand in his brewery. He was not just some guy living in his fancy home and letting someone else do the brewing. He was really paying attention to what was going on. And he put New Hampshire on the map. And by the way, he kept Portsmouth on the map. Portsmouth was an important Navy town. Portsmouth was an important shipping center. But by the 1870s, the shipping industry was dying out. So instead of Portsmouth becoming just another backwater New England port, Frank Jones Ale kept them on the map. Now, this is some views of their brewery about 1901. So this is before automated bottle lines or any automation. Now, what's interesting is that Frank Jones sold his brewery in 1888, after owning it for nearly 30 years, to an English company for $6 million. Now, the equivalent of that today is roughly $150 million. That's how much he sold it for. And so he made a boatload of money. Did he retire? No, he stayed on and still managed the brewery, you know, for another 20 years until his death in the early 1900s. So once again, he really loved his brewery. On the left, you can see the brew kettle there, and that's the master brewer. If any of you have been through a brewery tour, whether it's Budweiser here in New Hampshire, that picture looks familiar, doesn't it? The brewing industry, other than some of the scientific knowledge we have and some of the more automated controls, hasn't really changed that much. You know, it's often been said, you could bring a brewer from the 1850s or 1890s back from the dead, he would be able to figure out the craft pretty quickly. You know, he would probably be able to learn it pretty quickly. There's the filling stations. There were six or eight of those in Frank Jones Brewery, these little rooms. You can see India Pale Ale stamped on the kegs above. And one guy's filling six bottles at a time. He's got a helper there who's constantly bringing in more bottles. And then you've got a capping station on the far right there. So look at this belt-driven machinery. The hopper above holds the corks that go down into the bottle, and they're held on. I keep meaning to bring along. I have one of the old wire assemblies that went on top of it. Later, they would use porcelain to kind of hold that in place. So kind of like if any of you have drank Grolsch beer today, they use a porcelain stopper with a little, you know, metal gizmo on there. So that's kind of what they were doing. You can think of the other side of that wall, you know, think of rooms with these banks of coal-fired furnaces that were, and you know, guys or, you know, youths as young as, you know, 14 or 15 shoveling coal in there to keep the brewery operating. And that was pretty cool. So again, it wouldn't be for another, this is 1901, 1902, about another 10 years, they would have the automatic bottling lines that you can think of today. Not yet. We often think today of breweries as green industries, right? They kind of recycle, different methods to fire up their breweries. Frank Jones was a green, you know, brewing by its very nature was green. The spent grains that he had from his brewing process, you know, that's the biggest part of brewing, right? You've got to get rid of your spent grains. It's a waste product. Well, he gave them to local farmers. And one day a week, you would see horses and carriages, horse with carts lined up on the streets around his brewery, hoping to get their share of stuff that they could then feed to horses or pigs and stuff like that. So Red Hook Brewery in Portsmouth, when they were established, were doing the same thing, you know, giving that product to farmers. So what comes around goes around. Again, the leader in the state, the first one of the other breweries, M. Fisher and Sons, later became the Eldridge Brewery with the addition of a son-in-law. Massachusetts fellows that moved up to Portsmouth because they saw an opportunity. down in Chatham on Cape Cod, they were actually involved in freighting brewing commodities, grains and other things to New York and Philadelphia. And they finally decided to open a brewery right here in right in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. We can see the earliest iteration of that on the left one. It was M. Fisher and Sons. What's really important about that lithograph is a railroad coming to town, right? Because that turned every brewery from a very localized establishment to one that could get their product nationwide. So, and that really coincided with the boom of tourism in New Hampshire. So all of a sudden, you know, people in Guilford and Wolfboro and, you know, Conway, they're mostly drinking Frank Jones or other beers probably from Portsmouth. They're not drinking, no longer is a tavern keeper making his own beer. So that's how really that industry changed. I like this. You can see the brewery wagon heading back to the brew house there with these empty kegs that are returned. So we talk about an industry, if any of you have ever had a big party, you've rented it, you've gotten a keg of beer, you had to pay a deposit, you had to return it. Again, that's been part and parcel of the brewing industry since the beginning of time. You can notice the cask shed over here. So who's one of the major workers at a brewery back then? It's a cooper. It's the guy who makes barrels, repairs them, and so on. And so that idea of returning the barrel back to the brewery so it could be repaired and reused again, pretty cool business model. And as we'll see, a lot of lumbermen actually got involved in the brewing trade as well, because that was another outlet for their raw materials. As I said, later became the Eldridge Brewing Company. They were the second largest in the state behind Frank Jones. And when I say behind Frank Jones, I mean way behind Frank Jones. You look at the tax rolls, Frank Jones is up here and what they paid for taxes, Eldridge is down here. And then the third brewery is like down here. So the third brewery, that was the Portsmouth Brewing Company, was located right on Bow Street in Portsmouth. If you've ever been down there in that spot where you can overlook the harbor and see the Portsmouth tugs, that's where they were, right across from St. John's Church. So kind of fascinating. So that's the last iteration of the brewery. That center building right here is still present today, uses office buildings, but the rest of it's long gone. And Manchester, we talked about them. You had the Amiscate Brewery. Notice Andrew Wallace, proprietor, also manufacturer of and dealer in building, lumber, boards, clapboards, lathes. Notice he's got a stock ale, amber ale, porter, right in the squad district there. You've got Carney and Lynch, who advertise, again, their India Pale Ales, the stock cream ale, and so on. Barrels, half barrels, kegs, all sorts of sizes, again. So, and they also dealt in malt, so they were may have been supplying other brewers, possibly home brewers, to do some stuff. So you can see the different fellows that were in operation there. Manchester, obviously our largest mill city. Lots of mill workers means lots of beer. Okay. Other breweries, the Jones, True W. Jones Brewery. And if you're thinking, is that related to Frank Jones? Of course it is. True W. Jones is Frank Jones' brother. Now, unlike Frank Jones, he was actually a true brewmaster. He went to school, learned the trade. We should really call the Jones Brewing Company, though, a satellite brewery, because his brother almost certainly funded his operations. He was only in operation for 23 years before Prohibition kicked in. Frank, True W. Jones is a little bit of a sickly guy, so not quite the stamina of his brother. So, you know, he was pretty successful there in Manchester. You get an idea what his brewery looked like. Probably the most interesting one is the Fall Mountain Lager Brewing Company out in the western part of the state. And Walpole, New Hampshire, right on the Connecticut River, so plenty of water there and stuff. Sometimes they had their office in Bellow Falls across the river in Vermont, but they always brewed in New Hampshire. And that is interesting. They got started in 1876, and that was the, when it was built, that was the most modern brewery in America. It was built based on an exact model of one that was exhibited at the Philadelphia Centennial Exposition earlier in the year. And so these couple guys, Walker and Blake from Boston, built this brewery out in the middle of nowhere in Walpole. Walpole, no offense to Walpole, lovely town, is still really kind of out in the middle of nowhere. Not a ton of people there. That brewery had such a hard time. It was the most modern brewery. They never brewed to capacity because, once again, they depended on the Boston and Maine to get their product to market, and they did not have a big market. There just are not a lot of people in the Walpole or even that area around Vermont. So during their time in operation, 31 years until they finally collapsed in 1907, they had 9 different name changes. Their last iteration, I think, was the Crescent Brewing Company. During the Spanish-American War, they went by the Manila Brewing Company. They were the first brewing company in New Hampshire to undergo a labor strike in the late 1890s. Their workers there were not happy with their pay, and sometimes lack of pay, because the business was struggling. So that building, part of that building was still there along the Connecticut River. I'm not sure, since I've written my book, that it's still there. It was pretty dilapidated, but it might be. And they brewed, as their name said, mostly lager beers. So again, catering to something different, trying to create their own niche. And I think that was the other problem. People still wanted IPAs and things like that. You know, there was a nice craft brewery here not long ago down in Exeter that opened up. I can't remember the name of it. They're gone now. They were only open a couple years. And they didn't do IPAs. All they did were lagers. I'm a lager guy. I loved them. And they went out of business because everybody wants an IPA, right? So when you limit your audience, so to speak, or your consumers, that's what happens. And, location, 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 right? Now, I said New Hampshire has a lot of interesting things. A couple of things. Early on in the colonial era, there were a group of ministers in the seacoast who advocated that the association, the Piscataqua Association of Ministers, should build their own brewery and operate it. So these ministers would operate a brewery. By the way, ministers were some of the biggest imbibers of alcohol back then. There was one town in Hampton, people hated to, they loved their minister, don't get me wrong, but they hated it when he came to his house because he literally drank all of their fare. And he was also quite a large guy. He weighed over 300 pounds. So it's said that he drank all their stores, and it was really a hardship on the family. Now, these Piscataqua ministers thought, you know what, in a port town in Portsmouth, there's a lot of demon drinks, rum, whiskey, and that's really affecting local families. This was their argument. So if we can get the better stuff out there, beer, something that's cheaper, something we can provide that's, you know, less damaging, perhaps, that might help mitigate. They seriously considered it. Ultimately, it did not get built, but, you know, you gotta love New Hampshire's ministers. They love their beer. Now, the first female brewer that I know of in New England, I haven't studied outside of New England, was Mrs. Henry Evans. Martha Evans, by the way, is her name. She operated her brewery from 1864 to 1870. After the death of her husband, Henry Evans, an English immigrant. So she had 2 children to support after he died, so she operated the brewery on her own. So she was a brewmaster like her husband, apparently. The Cochico Brewery down in Dover. Anybody been to Dover? Anybody know Red Shoe Barn there? You guys know that place? My wife loves that place. That's where their brewery was, right next to the railroad, so very, very closely related. And I'm still waiting for a brewer today to name a beer after her, because I think that's pretty significant. Really the first female brewer in New England. So, New Hampshire's got that tradition, not only of the widows that were brewing at the tavern level, but also the first commercial brewery by a woman in New England is pretty significant. And that tradition continues today. Anybody been to Throwback in Northampton? I love that brewery. It's a great brewery, founded in 2010. Now, when they were founded in 2010, it was kind of a novelty, not to the women that formed it, but to the public. Oh, this brewery operated by women. This is like so unusual. And I saw that and I said, no, it's not unusual. It's really just hearkening back to our history. So Annette Lee and Nicole Carrier have done a great job down there. They support local agriculture. And, you know, a number of years later, they started the first brewing program at the University of New Hampshire. You can now get a degree in brewing at the University of New Hampshire because of these gals right here. So once again, even women in New Hampshire to this day are still making that contribution. I think that's a really cool aspect of brewing history that we don't often think about. So, and like I said, I love their stuff whenever I can stop. And they have great food too, by the way. Now, I love the brewing advertisements, right? Because they really kind of tell these stories. We all know the stories. You know, it's all about socializing, right? I mean, that's, you know, whether it's out with your loved one or with family or friends, having a drink, having a good time. And so you see these wide different advertisements. What happened to that one? I don't know how that one got sideways, but that's the upper scale one there. I don't know how that got twisted, but. And then you've got the Mountain Spring Brewery Company. That's our old friends over in Walpole. So they're trying a different name, one of their nine different names. A little bit more, frisky gal there. That looks like a fun place to go. This other place has a little dancing dog in it, though, so that might have been a good place to go, too. So it's all about these advertisements featuring, you know, ways to have fun and places to do it. And, of course, women have always been shown, portrayed in beer advertisements. They are to this day. But why were they doing that back, especially in the, you know, early post-Victorian era after, Queen Victoria's death? You know, why are we picturing these fancy women in the ads? The one on the far right, by the way, the Portsmouth Brewing Company, you know, they were featuring their lager beers, traditional German advertising, the German beer house kind of model there. That makes sense. But again, we can kind of think of the idea that sex sells. So nothing better to promote your product than a pretty woman, right? But the other thing is the temperance movement, right, was beating down anybody that consumed alcohol. They said, Thomas Nast, for example, the illustrator down in New York, is doing these graphic, dark drawings of, men hanging out in front of saloons and taverns, and instead of supporting their families, they're out drinking. And so brewers were trying to portray a different image of those who were drinking their beer. It's young ladies like this who are perfectly fine and upstanding citizens, not your average drunkard like you or me. So they were really trying to show, this polished image of the beer drinker. And that's really what that was all about. 1909 for that center ad, a little bit earlier, probably about 1902 for the Jones one there. You get the idea though. And it's a losing battle, of course, as we know. We know what's gonna happen with Prohibition. And what is also interesting in these ads is, what was once acceptable is now not acceptable, right? The idea of using children in a beer ad. There's a reason you don't see kids running around in a Budweiser advertisement. It's not allowed by the FTC, right? But back then, there were no advertising restrictions and stuff like that. So to have these, cute children, advertising for Frank Jones Brewing Company Limited in their Boston office, was perfectly okay. I'll tell you a funny story though. You guys may not know this, but any beer that is sold in New Hampshire has to be approved by the New Hampshire Liquor Commission. So if you're saying, why can't I get, let's just pick Yingling beer. A lot of people want that. Why can't I get it? Because they haven't come to an agreement with the New Hampshire Liquor Commission. They have to approve the sale. They have to approve the packaging. And there's fees to be paid, right? Let's be honest here. Founders Brewing Company out of Grand Rapids, Michigan, had a breakfast oatmeal stout, and they sell product in New Hampshire. They wanted to sell that. Well, their original picture on the thing, breakfast oatmeal stout, featured a picture of a baby. And the New Hampshire Liquor Commission said, can't do that. We can't have a picture of a baby on a beer bottle because that sends the wrong message, or someone might feed that to their child. And this went back and forth. Eventually, they did get it approved, but it just shows you the degree of control that we have today in New Hampshire over the brewing industry and what gets distributed. But also, the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission. And I'm not saying it's wrong, I'm just saying that's how it works today. The use of the automobile, automobile ownership in New Hampshire increased exponentially by 1905. It went from just a few people owning him at the end of the century, but we all know what Henry Ford did, right? And so by 1905, a lot of people owned automobiles. And so this idea, the roadside tavern, you could just stop, don't even have to get out of your car and have a drink. That was a real thing. So you wonder today, any of your friends or family wonder about New Hampshire's roadside liquor stores and say, how does that come to be? That's how it comes to be, right? Because you were allowed to do that. And we're not the only state that did that. There are other states that have drive-through liquor stores. You don't even have to get out of your car. Thankfully, the idea of drinking and driving really, Mad Mothers Against Drunk Driving really came about, but not until the 1980s. Prior to that, automobile advertising and beer advertising really went hand in hand. So we see, once again, how the times have changed. In that case, obviously, for the good. I always like, extreme sports, Coors sponsors the X Games. What's more extreme than ballooning, I guess? I just love this ad because it looks like that gal's, look at her waist, by the way. It looks like she's going to fall out of that balloon basket. Frank Jones, Portsmouth Ale, that's probably a Boston ad or something like that. So, and then on the other hand, you've got this very elegant setting for the Portsmouth Brewing Company. They're picking out not a bottle of wine, folks. They're picking out a bottle of beer, right? But they're using the same care as they would pick out a bottle of wine. Meanwhile, that waiter's kind of smirking in the background. He knows the guy's going to make the right choice and get a Portsmouth beer or some sort. So just some of the different ads. But, the temperance movement does come to pass. Unfortunately, it's a very interesting time in America's history. Was beer being brewed during temperance? Of course it was. You heard of bathtub gin. There were people going back to making beer. I've actually researched some police records. Police did not care about beer, right? They were looking at the hard drinks, rum, whiskey, rum runners coming up from, the Caribbean to Boston and then distributed from there. In New Hampshire, you also had, illegal liquor coming down from Canada and stuff like that. So beer was largely, from what I can see, left alone. I'm sure in every town, I'm sure even right here in Guildford, someone was making beer and someone knew someone who knew someone that they could get some of that. So it's kind of fascinating. Eventually, obviously, Prohibition would end in 1933 and come back. By the way, we think of Prohibition. It first went into effect during World War II on a partial basis, 1917, as America was entering World War I. And because of the wartime industry, brewing got very much constricted. So full prohibition didn't go until 1920. And of course, doesn't return until 1933. In the interim time, of course, all New Hampshire's breweries shut down. Now, in places like St. Louis, Budweiser was making all sorts of making food products out of their warehouses and out of their factories and stuff like that. They stayed in business. Our New Hampshire breweries didn't. My rough estimate of all the people put out of business by Prohibition, probably about 5,000 people, which is a significant amount for our population at the time. When you think of all the brewery workers, and then you think of, the servers, you think of the Teamsters that were trucking it around and stuff like that. And it never came back until after Prohibition. When it did, it came back very weakly. One brewery opened up, and of course it was named Frank Jones. It was actually in the old Eldridge Brewing Company, but they used the Frank Jones name and they used the old Frank Jones Master Brewer. So it's kind of interesting. On the left, you got Frank Jones Ale is back. Can you imagine? Anybody seen Ken Burns' special, right, about the end of Prohibition, the Prohibition years? It was an exciting time when beer came back. I like this one. Same formula, same brewmaster. Same body and flavor, same famous water. Now, I've never heard that before out of Portsmouth, so I'm not sure about that. You got Frank Jones beer. It's new label ensures new quality. I don't know what that means either, so different things. And, Frank Jones would stay in business till 1952, and then they would chug along, and then they would finally die out. This ad here is one of their last iconic ads, and it's really this idea, once again, of this wholesome young gal stopping alongside the road, pop the trunk and crack open a case of Frank Jones. You can't do that on the way home tonight, right? But that, again, association with the automobile was really very strong. Now, why did Frank Jones go out of business? And then we didn't have brewing in New Hampshire again until 1972, 22 years later, when Anheuser-Busch opened their plant in Merrimack. Other than that, there was no brewing. The brewing industry was changing after World War II. The young men that went off to war, when they came back, they did not want their father's beer. Ales were no longer popular in New England. They wanted lagers. They wanted something exciting. My grandfather, a New Englander, he went off to war, and he was a little bit older than most of the men. But when he came back, all he drank was Pilsner beer. Why? Because he was a tank guy, and his unit ended up in a little town called Pilsen, Czechoslovakia. And that's where he got to know Pilsner beer. That's all he drank the rest of his life, was Pilsner beer. He told me, I drank ale before that. After I got a taste for Pilsen beer, that's what I wanted. And that happened to a number of young men who got their first taste of beer in the service, supplied by the Navy or the Army, from big outfits like Pabst and Budweiser that were not ales. They were lager beers. So taste changed in New England. Also, that time period from the 50s until the 1970s, the 80s, was a time of consolidation in the American brewing industry. Local brewers are vanishing every year by the hundreds. Larger conglomerates like Budweiser and, you know, Miller and stuff like that taking over. And also our beers, frankly, were terrible. You know, by the 1980s, American beer was a worldwide joke. Now, there were some pockets of good brewing done out in San Francisco. Anchor Steam Brewery was still going out in Portland, Oregon. You know, Blitz Weinhard Brewery was doing good work out there. Down a little town in Texas, Shiner Brewery was still making good, Eastern European style beer. But other than that, most of the beers that you saw were lousy. And then the craft brewing revolution comes along. And you know who you got to thank for that? Anybody want to guess what president helped out with that?
Jimmy Carter.
Yeah, one of the few good things many people would say that he did, right? He reduced the restrictions on how much craft brewers could brew, and that really sparked a revolution in the craft brewing industry. And that's why it really got to start out in the West, places like Denver, Portland, Seattle, all these meccas today of craft brewing to this day. And then it slowly spread east, and including into conservative New Hampshire. Massachusetts actually had more craft brewing before New Hampshire did, believe it or not. So even though Massachusetts was heavily restricted, New Hampshire was more restrictive because of the New Hampshire Liquor Commission. But eventually we even got into the mix there. And like I said, today, I can't even track where we have close to 100 breweries in New Hampshire. We have more than Vermont does. We have equally good beer. I get it that there's some great IPAs in Vermont, but there's a lot of good beers that are being brewed here. And I'm not a beer snob. I'll try a lot of different things. I don't drink light beers. I will say that. I don't want anything to do with that if I'm going to drink a beer. But, some of these New Hampshire beers especially, some of these really good ones, when I sit back on a night, whether I'm reading a book or watching a ball game or whatever, it just really makes me think about our brewing past and how I'm kind of connecting even to those first settlers who were drinking some amazing beer, no doubt, on their own. So with that, I'll open it up to any questions. I do have a copies of my book if you're interested. Father's Day and Mother's Day is coming up. But we got pretty samples. I'm going to have one now. Does anybody have any questions? No questions. All right, we got to drink some beer then. I'll stick around for a few minutes, but I want to thank everyone for coming tonight. Yeah.